think this morning we're just going to start off immediately. So I'm going to hand over to our keynote speaker. So I'd like to introduce to you Pauline Tambling, CBE, who's the Joint Chief Executive of Creative and Cultural Skills, and Linda Jasper, MBE, who's the Director of Youth Dance England. And I believe Pauline is going to start first. Thank you.
I'm going to come forward because it seems a bit intimidating being that far away from all of you. So if anyone is having problems with sight lines or sound, please let me know. I've been asked to talk a little bit about the future of work in the dance sector. It shouldn't be your problem, but unfortunately, unless we all get together and do something about it, it might be. So I'm going to give you some facts and figures and suggestions for some of the debates we might take forward in the second half of this session. For those of you who haven't heard of Creative and Cultural Skills, we're a charity that's been in operation since 2005. We support the economic growth of the creative industries across the UK, and we're licensed by an agency called the UK Commission for Employment and Skills as one of 18 sector skills councils which work across areas of the economy, such as food and drink, manufacturing, and construction. We try to raise standards in our footprint, and our footprint covers craft, design, cultural heritage, visual arts, music, literature, the performing arts, and dance. And I joined Creative and Cultural Skills in 2007, having spent nearly 30 years in the arts, both in arts organisations and in a funding body. But as a sector skills council, we provide research and reform qualifications and present the sector's industrial needs and employment needs to government. That's a very different perspective. We also run a UK-wide National Skills Academy, which brings together education institutions with arts organisations to help young people into the world of work in the creative industries. And until we published our labour market intelligence in 2008, there hadn't been any common data about how our sector compares with other parts of the economy. There's quite a lot of what you might call vanity publications, I guess, in the arts sector, and I've been part of that, where we try to prove the value of the arts. But what we have to do is to use the common methodology that the UK Commission requires of us, and it's quite helpful because although the statistics are not often as good as we would like them, at least they are very credible with politicians. So it's been incredibly enlightening to understand the workforce issues, and my talk today is from that perspective. For example, we talk about the art sector as if it's equivalent to the health and education sectors, for example. Now, in terms of employment figures, it is, with approximately 1.5 million people working in each of those three sectors. And actually, incidentally, the financial sector is the same size. But not in the available funding available to pay people who work in the sectors. So when I was at Arts Council England about 10 years ago, the National Health Service, which basically funds all health in England, overspent its budget by 1% in that year. And that was exactly the same as the whole of government expenditure on the arts. So that gives you a feel for the sort of challenge we face in terms of creating a workforce for the creative industries and for sectors like dance that operate primarily within the public sector. But despite this, the creative industries are thriving. According to the Department for Culture, Media and Sports statistics, the creative industries create $70 billion per year to the UK economy. Again, not dissimilar to the financial services sector. And employment increased in our world by 8.6% between 2011 and 12, so right in the middle of the recession, compared to 0.7% in the UK economy as a whole. So this makes the creative industries the fastest growing sector in the UK, and no sign of slowing down. And interestingly, across three recessions, the employment figures for people working in the creative industries has never dipped. We are more or less recession proof. However, it doesn't feel like that. So how does the dance sector fit into this? Well, research from 2013 indicates that there are around 14,500 dancers or choreographers working in the UK. Now, this is an official figure taken from what people say, and you'll all do this every 10 years, what you say in the census or when you respond to government data or when you fill in any form or when you submit your NI figures and so on. So these are the people who actually are officially earning their living from dance. However, work by Arts Council England suggests that the ecology of dance is larger, with some 40,000 people involved in dance in some capacity. And that'll include dance teachers, ad hoc project workers, part-time folk, voluntary work, participatory practice, social dance, and people whose main income is not from dance as well. And I'm pretty sure that that will include a lot of people in this room. So we know that the majority of people are struggling to make a living through their dance practice. Like other art forms, dance is a sector split between a handful of superstar artists and a long tail of low-paid practitioners. Arts Council England estimates that 40% of those who work in dance earn £5,000 to £20,000 per year, and almost 25% earn less than £5,000 per year. That's from their dance practice. So given the context of current available funding to the four UK Arts Councils, the most likely area of new work for dance practitioners will be in participatory settings, teaching, and not in performing and choreography, where the figures will stay pretty much constant. Now, a lot of dance practitioners work with schools, hospitals, pupil referral units, healthcare settings, and I can see from the programme that a lot of you work in those fields. That's often funded by lottery, including from the Arts Councils, or through grant-making trusts. The quality of this work appears to be consistently good, and I'm not going to touch much on content today because actually that's not the problem. Most of the practice that goes on in these settings is reliable and often excellent. Research by Artswork for Paul Hamlin Foundation has found that a high proportion of practitioners have specialist qualifications such as undergraduate and postgraduate degrees, take part in professional training, improve their work by sharing best practice. And that's in a sector where you don't get much financial benefit for doing any of that. Qualifications are not an issue, as over 60% of the dance workforce have a degree. But practitioners on the ground are finding it harder and harder to get work, even though the wider creative industries are thriving. Why is this? Well, there's a host of reasons. Art sector cuts hit freelancers disproportionately, and a lot of practitioners are freelance. Across the public sector, intermediary bodies like People Dancing are out of fashion with arts funders, and artists rely on these agencies to broker partnerships and projects, particularly with non-arts bodies, and that's where the growth is. The public sector is cutting back, and growth is in the commercial sector. And for all the evidence of its value, one could hardly say that participatory practice is securely embedded in the minds of arts funders, let alone non-arts commissioners. Most activity has been project funded and individually negotiated with sympathetic partners in other sectors, and it's easy to cut. And because dance starts from a low base in terms of the numbers of people working in the art forms, the amount of funding coming to it from arts funders, it will always get hit harder. In sum, the work opportunities for this practice are ad hoc and unreliable. So against this backdrop, I'd like to suggest two challenges that we have to address in order to achieve participatory practice. And those who know me and know that I've got a background in this work will know that I've been saying some of these things for probably 30 years, but it's probably worth saying them again in the current context. So firstly, the old story, and I know I'm preaching to the converted, but I do think we have to find a way to solve this problem. We have to get more take-up of dance in schools. We need to remember that we're not in the business of lobbying to protect dance. We're in the business of making the case for dance in the first place. Dance has always been marginal in schools. And I'd like to suggest that the arts sector has spent rather too much time lobbying arts funders about this, and perhaps not enough driving up demand for schools via parents and the young people themselves. Quite simply, parents are not banging on the doors of their schools asking for dance. We need them to. We're seeing arts subjects in decline at key stage 3 and 4, in part due to the education reforms, and if I had an extra hand, I'd put that in inverted commas. And this is particularly true of schools that have a high proportion of young people from low-income backgrounds. Examination numbers aren't everything, but they do give a sense of the scale of the problem. Around 12,000 students a year take GCSE dance, and 2,000 take A-levels. Now, that's in the context of 160,000 taking art and design at GCSE and 21,000 taking fine art, and around 400,000 taking English. So we can hardly say it's got a foothold. In 2012-13, there were 4,650 full-time students of dance in higher education. For the dance sector to thrive, we need the population at large to engage with it. You all know this. High-profile projects like Big Dance and media profiles like Strictly are critical to raise the profile, but they need to be backed up by ongoing opportunities delivered by schools and dance practitioners week in, week out. We can discuss how to do this in the Q&A. Teachers and schools are our best collaborators. Unless we have a solid offer for all young people in every neighbourhood, dance will remain marginal. The other big challenge is finding new financial models other than grant funding. Dance has never been one of the big beneficiaries of arts funding, and things will not get better. There's no point hoping for things to return to how they were. They weren't even good then. Artists need to seek new ways to make their practice sustainable, and this means finding customers, a dirty word, who want the activity and are prepared to pay for it. That said, there's no such thing as new practice, just practice that isn't in fashion. And I think many of you here are pioneers of this work and hold the secret of how to take it to scale. But we've all been guilty of giving stuff away, raising money, and then giving it away rather than creating an overarching sustainable funding model that where this work can thrive. An example, we've been working with Skills for Care, the Workforce Development Agency for Social Care, a sector with frightening employment gaps because of demographic changes. There are opportunities for artists within participatory expertise to work on a major scale in care contexts. And the care sector just doesn't know about the work you're doing. We had a meeting recently with some practitioners and it was eye-opening to the care sector. We are missing embedded roots into these sorts of workplaces from entry level onwards. Arts organisations will never fund the work on the scale that could happen, and we need to find a way of engaging directly with those commissioners of work who see dance in, say, residential settings or, say, with people with dementia as an improved quality of life offer, not a nice to have. Embedding vocational roots is part of the shift. At Creative and Cultural Skills, we've created 3,500 apprentices places for the creative sector from a standing start of zero in 2008. We are the national provider for the Arts Council's Creative Employment Programme, and we're about to launch the same programme in Northern Ireland. We support employers, and many of you will be employers, even though you're an employer of one, to create apprenticeships and paid internships roles for the next generation. I'd like to see more dancers, dance companies, dance commissioners engaging with this program more systematically to get young people into the dance workforce. So my offer here today is to come and talk to us at Creative and Cultural Skills about putting some employment opportunities for young people into your dance practice to grow the next generation. And my challenge is, instead of lamenting what is bound to be a decreased pot of arts funding for the work we do, let's find a new model for funding some of this activity, which we know is of critical importance. I welcome a debate about this in the next half hour. Thank you.
Okay, morning everybody, hi. It's great following Pauline, actually, because we are going to be touching on many of the same things. I think what I've got to do is probably to give you a bit more information about the dance sector, but you'll see an awful lot of themes occurring between us. I'm just going to go back here because I can't remember all the stats and I have to read them out. Okay, so the question I'm going to ask And you know about Youth Dance England, and it is the National Development Agency for Children and Young People's Dancing and Beyond School, and where we champion dance with and by young people. So what I'm going to do is ask myself this following question. So in the UK, we often say we are world leaders in dance education and training. And I'm just asking that question, can we still uphold that in the light of the major reductions to public funding over the past few years? I'm going to draw on information particularly from England, because that's what I know best in and beyond schools, but also refer to other UK countries and some countries overseas. And I want to try to, together with Pauline and the rest of us, find ways forwards for children and young people's dance. So, in, like Pauline, in school, that's where I'm going to start. We've seen enormous, fast changes. I have never seen so much change so quickly in the summer of 2010 after the new government was elected as I have in 30 years of work. The school system is very important if we're going to work, because it is where all children and young people should have a free access to dance education. And what is at the moment stopping us kind of getting into schools is not only parents, it's quite right, Pauline, but it's also the structures that are now being created. The new school structures, with the intent to raise standards, have been engineered by government to have a direct relationship with schools through direct funding, so that we loosen the ties between schools and local authorities. The new schools, mainly called academies and free schools, are run as individual businesses and have far more freedom to run their affairs, including not to deliver the national curriculum. And 18% now of all state schools in England are academies or free schools, and that is expected to rise. So what we have is fragmentation. We now have 7 different types of publicly funded schools in England. And so therefore, the advisory structures have gone, and what's happened is in this vacuum that's been created, the new academies are creating their own networks. So, for example, in London, the academy chain of the Harris Academy chain now have their own dance network of teachers, and there are also consortia of academy schools coming together to create their own networks. So the curriculum, this is also at the moment quite a concern. You've all heard about Nicky Morgan this week, in fact, the Secretary for Education, where she has warned young people that choosing to study arts subjects at school could hold them back for the rest of their lives. And this, actually, she's speaking, at least she's being honest in terms of revealing the government's true, understanding of the value of arts. And what they are actually driving at is STEM, which I'm sure that you all have read about. And it's driven by the need to become more competitive in the world, especially in economically challenged times. So schools, even those rated good by inspectors, want to do even better and become outstanding on league tables. So competition between schools has the effect of narrowing the curriculum and focusing on academic subjects, not the arts. And as Pauline said, this has had the effect of the different inspection regimes of 15% of schools withdrawing more than one art form from their curriculum. But an even more worrying is those that with high percentage of free school meals, 21% of those have actually withdrawn one or more art subject from the curriculum, compared to 8% of schools with a low proportion of free school meals. So dance in the national curriculum. In England and Wales, dance remains an activity within PE. It was a struggle to retain dance in PE in the latest consultation in England in 2013, with the government's focus on competitive games. The PE curriculum in England describes dance as a performative physical activity, not as an artistic form. However, if it was not in PE, it would be nowhere in the curriculum. Whereas in Scotland, it is in the expressive arts. And in Australia, it is placed in the arts in their first ever national curriculum. However, we also should remember that in other European countries, such as Belgium, France, Germany, Netherlands, dance is not on the curriculum at all, but delivered as an extracurricular activity or project base within the curriculum. So touching on workforce in a minute, the majority of people, as Pauline says, a lot of people are working in teaching. In schools, though, the majority of teaching of dance is taught by non-specialists. In our last survey of teachers back in 10-11, we found that only 10% had a dance qualification. And obviously in England, we have now 4 PGC courses non-north of London, and there are no PGC dance courses in Wales. Often students in Wales access the English courses, and Scotland has just begun to produce its first ever postgraduate qualification initial teacher training. So the other change to England, which I would canvass personally, Scotland and Wales and Northern Ireland not to take up, is actually focusing more on in-service, on the job training in schools, which for dance is also a problem, as we haven't got that many people who can maybe adequately train people on the job in schools. Examinations in dance, as Pauline said, she's given you the global numbers. I just want to give you a bit of background to that. It is true, around 2,000 are taking GCSE dance a year in England and Wales. However, the background to that is between 2008 and 2013, there's been a minus 12% reduction in those numbers, and in A-level, a minus 17% reduction in take-up of all A-levels in dance. The figures are a bit skewed because obviously there is BTEC, which is within performing arts, and it's very hard to see the numbers for people specialising in dance through that route because it's not recorded in that way. However, we saw a few shoots of recovery last year, as there was a 3% increase back to GCSE in dance, but we're still talking about low numbers. However, in Scotland, smiles again, the Scottish Qualification Authority, in the new qualifications for dance taking off at national and higher levels, they have had a 47% increase in numbers over that time, alongside their new curriculum for excellence. But some of the figures that have just come out about taking part in dance, and this is a government survey they do every year, which asks the same questions around people taking part in sport, going to museums, theatres, arts, all sorts of things. And these are the numbers for dance. So in that period, 2008 to 2013-14, so there was a 33% decrease in 5 to 10-year-olds taking part. Note, there was also a decline in all participation in arts in this age group, which is why there really is a concern in primary schools. If you look at the decrease in 11 to 15-year-olds taking part, that's also significant, but even more so is when you read the report, you see that that is set against a sustained or even increased participation in most of the other art forms during the same period. So dance has performed extremely badly, particularly within 11 to 15-year-olds. And that is where they actually take part in dance, in school, both in and out of school and out of school only. So you can see why it really is important that we actually do something with schools. So the decrease perhaps affected through the economic downturn, people not paying for things to go outside of school and take part in dance, changes to schools' priorities, which we've discussed, and cessation of funding for Youth Dance England's national network, and also Youth Sport Trust, school sport partnerships as well. So we're now going to look at outside of school and wider interventions. So the Arts Councils are taking now a very different role. It is very noticeable to me, who's been in the sector for a long time, that the Arts Councils in Wales, England and Scotland are intervening in education where at one time they would not have seen it as their role. Perhaps responding, as we can see, to the respond the demand from the sector and aiming to increase participation. Also, as public funding is reducing, so the size of government departments are decreasing too. So what we're finding is they're handing over more of the work that they used to run by the civil servant to the arts councils, particularly the music education hubs is the case in point in England. So shortening the arms of the arm's length principle. An arts council has invested significantly in bridge organisations in England to bridge the gap between schools and the cultural sector. A similar project is being delivered in Germany called Cultural Agents. In Wales, there will be a joint investment between the DfE and Arts Council Wales to fund the implementation of the Arts and Creative Plan that has come from a report for the Welsh Government into arts and education. And 20 million is going to be funded over 5 years for that to be implemented. Creative Scotland has commissioned Y Dance and the Royal Conservatoire to write a first postgraduate diploma in dance education. Now, that 10 years ago, I could not imagine. So out of school, the Arts Council funded sector, we have had reductions, obviously, in public funding. We all know about that. In the youth dance network in England, the regional lead agencies from 2011 were told to, and asked to, not told to, arts councils don't do that, asked the regional organisations to embed the work that they were doing with Youth Dance England into their core work. Now, due to variances between programmes, funding and focus, this has been differently interpreted by the regional lead organisations. The lack of a national network of young people's dance, I think, is leading to a lack of cohesion and fewer opportunities for young people to participate in dance. We're particularly noticing this at a local level with UDance registration. However, stats produced from the Arts Council that's just come out in London, because they've done London region first and they're going to do the others next, apparently, show that 71% of their funded organisations are planning to deliver children and young people's work 2015 to 18. So youth dance. Well, the youth dance sector remains strong, even though there are many cases of organisations losing their funding and independent artists having to find ways of continuing to fundraise and subsidise their own work, sometimes from their own pocket. We estimate that there are between 850 and 1,000 youth dance groups in England. They are run and funded very differently, but they remain a very important access point and progression route for young people. I just want to mention hip-hop. And this has been, for me, the most interesting development. They certainly have new business models. They've operated completely, till very recently, outside the publicly funded sector. And they have had enormous success in reaching hundreds and hundreds of young people in their work. And they offer progression routes to training, which is of particular importance to their area, where there is little vocational and HEI provision. I just wanted to focus on what I think is an interesting change, really, here in the focus on progression routes. In this climate of cuts to public funding, this is the area that has been retained, even though not kept up with inflation, is the publicly funded pre-vocational training centre in England, the Centres for Advanced Training and the Vocational Residential Schools. This government has also supported the creation of a national youth dance company, which joins now the other companies in Scotland and Wales. Perhaps, Pauline, we've made our argument to this government about the importance of creating a world-class workforce for the cultural industries. And these developments are very useful for dance. It is imperative that young people, no matter where they come from, can get that early training if they want to be a professional performer. But what we are engaged with here are relatively small numbers of young people, which means that the financial commitment is containable, whilst I would say the government intervention is highly visible. So we've created a range of opportunities for talent development, but access to them is being eroded. Just a note on higher education, as Pauline has said, it's remained buoyant. We're amazed that with the introduction of student fees in England, that would have had a decrease in student numbers, but that's not been the case. We've had a 25% increase in people taking up BA courses in dance, which peaked in 2011. For example, in 2013-14, there were 1,395 first-year students taking dance degree courses. That's quite a workforce. Private dance sector remains the largest provider of dance teaching for children and young people, especially for girls and young women. On the examination of their annual reports over the past 3 years, it's quite clear that following the economic downturn in 2008-10, they've actually weathered the storm through actually doing all kinds of different projects, but also redressing imbalances between outgoings and incomings. And what they've done is been able to stabilise themselves, which is very commendable. And I've noted as well that in the private sector, there's a real increase in genres being offered, cheer dance, Bollywood, all kinds of things that those of you who were at the Albert Hall dance proms probably witnessed a few weeks ago. And there are many boundaries within their own workforce now of them actually working in schools and also offering within their own studios GCSE and A-level dance courses. So, new opportunities, like Pauline, we have to think broadly. As public funding becomes tighter and more competitive, it's driving more collaboration between organisations. Basically, we need to join up to make the money go further or to attract it in the first place. Schools may have to join together to offer an arts and dance curriculum, make relationships jointly with artists, share resources and staff. Some enterprising people have set up arts and creative industries focused schools within the new school structures. So we've got a free school in Rye in East Sussex that's focused on the performing arts. More of you will be delivering dance programmes in schools using different project funding, including the PE and sport premium funding. Now, I want to talk about this quickly because this, I think, is one of the only parts of national funding I know in England that can be used for dance in schools, and it's funded by, interestingly, the Department for Education and the Department for Health. And every primary school is getting £9,000 a year to enrich their PE and sport offer, and dance, as you know, is at key stage one and two, so schools could be spending money on dance. And this funding is now until 2020, depending on the outcome of the next election. And we have an information sheet on our website. Please do make sure that people are using it wisely. The public health, I think, is one of the most useful opportunities we may have, not without its challenges, but with the increase in obesity and other health problems and the nearly bankrupt NHS, we do know that in England that the public health budget is going to be increased from 1% to 10%. Now, that means billions of pounds. And there is no other art form that has such an important part to play in this area. And you can see in the change of language already that we are moving away from sports to talking of physical activity and even dance in the frameworks and even sports organisations' communications. So in the PE and sports strategy in Wales, dance is included in their programmes, and Why Dance in Scotland has been funding for many years to run dance projects to get more people active. So to answer the question I raised, So I think the UK can still be seen as a world leader. Dance is included in statutory national curricula. We have a well-developed youth dance sector. We have publicly funded pre-vocational training, a private dance sector that is expanding the dance genre it offers. We have means of producing a workforce, even though not well spread across the UK. And we have a very well-developed professional dance education work and independent artists delivering exceptional practice. However, dance remains a marginalised art form. And even though we are starting from a higher base than many other countries, we have seen significant reductions in participation in dance in and beyond schools by young people since 2010. So there are new opportunities bubbling up, but if we need to be ready to apply them to dance, we will have to even work even harder and in partnership with more organisations. But we do have unique services and experience to offer. Our problem, as Pauline was saying, is a matter of scale. For example, can we come together to secure commissioning funds for health with diminished funded networks? Supporting infrastructure is rarely prioritised, but absolutely essential. This is what other countries envy about our system, is that we have development and umbrella bodies for dance that can profile our art form and connect people and practice together. We will all have to continue to make the case for dance, but now, thankfully, there are many more of us to do it. So when considering what's next, I was struck by a report on a seminar run by the Royal Society of Arts and Arts Council England in 2013. The discussion focused on not only making the case, but considered an even more important issue: how are we going to deliver arts education in these very changed circumstances? And this is a summary of what the synopsis of that seminar said. So basically, yes, we have to continue making the case, but we need to think more about how we move forward in a period where there will be less national prescription to schools and reduced funding to the arts. What steps can we take, and whose responsibility is it to make it all happen? Well, we are a creative and resilient and pragmatic sector. Let's see what we can do to make it happen in these very challenging times.
Of statistics. I think the good thing is that we agreed about most things. The question is, do you? And Chris, how long can we have for questions?
I think we can go until
7 minutes past.
Chris says we can go till 7 minutes past.
Knowing that you'll take till 10, so that's okay.
Okay, and we've got roving mics. Any points or questions?
I'm Gemma Canvelli from Dance Digital. Thank you both for your speeches. It was great to hear and very provoking. I just want to ask, you said that there's an increase in dance app, CAT, and kind of professional, further progression routes. However, that's only a regional, regional outlook. In terms of countywide, my response to that is that there's a decrease in those progression rates, because obviously there's not access to it at schools, and that's something we need to increase. Are you finding that as well, that there's a decrease in at county level? Are you looking at those statistics as well as regional routes?
Yeah, it's very hard to have the data at the county and local authority level because there's nobody doing it. So we don't know. I think that when I look around the country and in England and look around, I would say you're right. And what I've said here today is that I think the access points are being diminished, and the actual progression routes have been secured, even though, you know, there's less money, but they are there. But what's happening is that there's a decrease in the amount of resource in schools and outside of schools at that very ground level to actually get more people involved and actually provide the starting points for those progression routes. Absolutely, yes.
And if the base of the pyramid is getting smaller, it doesn't really matter how good it is at the top. It'll be like a building that's left to become derelict. It will just actually get undermined. And I think Linda's really correct to say that the government's very good on these signals that make it look as if they're doing a lot of wonderful things, but they're very bad about the infrastructure. Mm-hmm. So an example that I inherited at the Arts Council of England in 1998, when £100 million was leaving local authority music education, but we were pressed from DCMS, arm's length principle and all that, to create youth music, which got 10 million a year. And I think these figures that are bandied around, you know, 20 million for this, 10 million for that, 5 million for this, if you're talking about something at grassroots, you need many, many more hundreds of millions than that. Mm. So I think that's the problem.
For example, Youth Sport Trust, some people in the room might be able to remember better than me, but they got 176 million over 3 years to set up the school sport partnerships. It was something in that region. And that's what it takes. And that was to set up clusters with eight schools, I think more or less eight schools, with one coordinator in the middle, with a hub and spoke model. But that was about 176 million, was it, Veronica? Can't remember, it was something like that. And music education hubs, how much is the bill for that at the moment?
It's north of 100 million, isn't it?
Yeah. It's more than 100 million. But that's, you know, that's what it takes if you want to try and get access at a local level.
Over there? Is there a mic over there?
Hello, my name is Derek from Pavilion Dance Southwest. I was interested to hear your perception, Pauline, around where the main opportunities or most of the opportunities are for dance practitioners. And I wondered if either of you had a view as to whether the vocational and undergraduate opportunities for dance training matched the opportunities for work, or whether there was a dysfunction there.
No.
What are we going to do about that, then?
That's a very interesting one. I mean, I think, as Linda said, the government has been quite clever in identifying the routes into professional practice, because it's in their interest not to dismantle the excellent dance practice that is in this country. Mm. It has always been the case, I think, in dance in all arts training, actually, that there is this mismatch between what young people are seduced into doing, which is to become a performer, and the real jobs are actually not there. And I mean, I've had more experience in music than in dance, but in music it's almost as if you take everyone through the process, and then at the end, when they've spent 10 years in, you know, instrumental teaching, they've gone on to do a degree, they've probably done a final postgraduate degree, and then they end up doing participatory music or community music or whatever, and that was never the plan. And I think that's a real shame, because I think we need to up the profile of this wider work. Yeah. And a conservatoire head told me one time, well, you're never going to actually get students if you say to them they're going to be doing dance education or dance in, you know, this or the other. I think we've got to change that whole paradigm. Yeah.
So just a follow-on from that, I mean, we down in Bournemouth are attempting to set up a new degree with the Arts University Bournemouth, which is currently live, by the way, if anyone's interested, but trying to address that, although we recognise the reality of selling that to particularly 18-year-olds may still be difficult.
Yeah.
However, I think there is a shift now in terms of parents' attitudes around work opportunities and the workforce, so that may be the way to try to sell the story.
I think you're right, and I think it's very early on in somebody's life at the age of 17 to be able to understand what the world of work is like, and particularly in an area as complicated as dance and creative industries. And it's not only the job, I don't think, of HEI and vocational trainers to do that job. I see it as a partnership, because I've worked in a university as well for many years, and you do have to have time with students to be able to really imbue them and allow them to develop and understand their subject, you know, to a high level. You've got to be able to do that. They are at a university. However, within that, and I know many university courses have, you know, modules, they have training placements, and I used to run a four-year course, and it was a sandwich course. But every other profession I know as well would never think that after 3 years that you're fully formed professional. You know, if you look at law, you look at health, you look at all sorts of things, you would then have to carry on training. I think the problem is for dance is the shortage of money and the prospect of not having a very large salary. So therefore, even though, as Pauline says, people do invest in their CPD, it's very hard when you're now 21, leaving with an enormous debt, to then think, oh my goodness, I've now got to really invest in my training further in order to be really useful and get a job. But to be frank, they have. But I do think we need better partnership between particularly the publicly funded arts and creative sector and universities like you're describing, Derek, because it's our shared responsibility. I do not think it is just universities or vocational, because they haven't time and they've got to do not only upskill and develop those students, they have got to give them a glimpse of the world of work, of course they do, to orientate their practice. But we can't leave it all to them. It's not fair and it's not realistic.
One in the middle here, Veronica.
Veronica Jobbins at Trinity Laban. I think I'm the only person here that represents one of the Centres for Advanced Training. And so I just want to go back and make an observation because absolutely there is an issue around access into the Centres for Advanced Training that I think is going to emerge over the next few years and be more striking. At the moment, I think we can all say we recruit well and we recruit fairly appropriately, because it's important to remember that the scheme was set up to ensure that people can come in, whatever their background, to access high quality training. The issue is, if your broad-based access work is weak, you're not going to get into the schemes the sorts of people that really represent who should be coming through. And the CATs are finding we're having to work much harder to actually make the links into, for instance, the school sector, as that becomes more and more fragmented. So that is a real issue for us, because we can't do that on our own. We don't have the sorts of financial base. We don't have we have a very limited amount of outreach funds to make those links in. So it is extraordinarily worrying if the access routes break down, because, you know, 5-10 years' time, who's coming through the CATs into higher education? They're going to be a very particular sort of young person. And that is not what we want, and we certainly don't want that as a sector. So I, you know, really just backing what you're saying, and just to everyone in the room, can you please support your local CAT and actually make contact so that we can actually keep improving those access routes?
Yeah, I think the picture about the change of school structure, with them being now much more accountable to the department as opposed to being accountable to local authorities, is actually helpful in some ways. I mean, I think the place where you will not find schools cutting the arts is in the independent sector, and that is in part because all independent school head teachers know that their clients, their parents, are not buying exam results, they're buying an all-round education, which includes drama, music, dance, theatre, and all those things. I think what's happening in the academies is that those schools are starting to emulate that. So I'm not surprised that the Harris Academy has got a network of dance teachers. I chair a studio school myself, and I know that there's a lot of enthusiasm within the governing body to create opportunities for dance. We've got a lot of problems with young people not liking traditional sport. So they are looking to dance and to leisure centres as a different way. The obesity issue is real in governing bodies' minds. The protection issues are real. So I think there's a real opportunity there
The problem is you can't have one conversation. You've got to have a conversation with 28,000 schools, and that's a bit complicated. Yeah. And it might be worth people dancing, thinking about some of those conversations. Yeah. So we could break them down, you know, 28,000 divided by all the people who work in the dance sector would probably be more doable. Yeah. But it unfortunately, it's every school now decides what it's up to, and where you've got academy groups, you've got a little bit, you know, a bit more flexibility because you've got one conversation for several schools. But those trusts, those multi-academy trusts, are interested in providing a quality education for their young people, and that does include the arts and sport.
I think for individual practitioners, this is a big part of your work going forwards. And whereas, you know, when I was an animateur in one county, at least I had a central point to go to. You know, the thought of me now trying to do what I did in Berkshire with this new system, it would mean I would have to have at least three or four of me to be able to go and have all these different conversations. But that is what we're going to have to do. And I think that is the massive change, is that people who are working on the ground really do have now the responsibility, sorry, but you do, to make all those partnerships work locally for you, for dance, because it's getting harder and harder for national bodies. We can help with advocacy, we do it all the time, and policy and all of those things, but in the end, it will be your connections with those head teachers, those governors, to make things happen where you are. And I think that is the massive change that's come about.
Chris has allowed us one more question, if there is one. One at the top there. Someone's got the microphone already.
Hello, yes, I've got it. Hi, I'm Vika from Yorkshire Dance. And two things. Very briefly, Linda, you mentioned in Holland dance not being on the curriculum at all. But, of course, like every small town in England who has its own leisure centre where you can go and do classes, every small town in Holland has its own cultural centre where you can learn instrumental skills and dance very cheaply. So that's, we don't, yeah. Massive yeah. difference yeah, in the infrastructure. Just a question. It strikes me listening to you, Linda, in particular, just incredibly important your role is at, in advocacy and lobbying. And I know how much you've done in the past. And, of course, Dance UK plays a big part. And as well as advising us on a local level what we should each be doing, is there anything that we could be doing to make your lobbying role more effective? Because you need to have those conversations we can't be having.
I think I need to have from you is more examples of how you're making these partnerships work on the ground. So more and more case studies, and I don't mean long case studies, I mean snapshots of how you're working with your local health partners, how you're working, you know, with academy chains if you manage to get into them, or whatever. Is really good ammunition to show that these are the different models that we can use for making dance happen on the ground. And I think that's what Ofsted is very interested in, our inspectorate in England, and that's what the people I'm talking to at the Department of Health as well want as well. Examples.
And I would say arm yourself with those statistics, because whatever Nicky Morgan says, the reality is that there's more jobs, we're growing more jobs in this sector than they're growing in the science sector at the moment. Yeah. So some of the things that are being said are not true. So make sure you have got the facts at your fingertips, the data, the information that you can get from Chris, from these PowerPoints, and use that on the ground, because there are opportunities there. They're not the same opportunities, different funding structures, but it is all possible.
Pauline and Linda, thank you very much indeed. I just have two notes for you, more notes. Coffee is in the Western Studio, which is one level down, but I'm sorry to say, on the other end of the building. And then
the section Frameworks and Partnerships is actually happening in the Victor Salvi room. And to get to that, you just come back to just in front of the foyer here, but follow it around, and it's a room with white curtains down the side. It's a kind of a big room of